This week's episode of So Wrong It's Right was brought to you by Foxy Bingo. Put some Fox in your day with new, quick and interactive bingo experiences all at the tip of your finger. They have a huge range of free, classic and exclusive games you can play with your mates to keep the party going. Want to connect with other players? Foxy Bingo has a community chat so you can always feel part of the Foxy pack. So get your Fox on by heading to Foxy Bingo today. 18 plus, begambleaware.org, T's and C's apply. I've been out in public on a red carpet on a TV show. I mean, you're beautiful, but you've looked better.
Katie Price wants you on a shoot in my Bayer. You've got to fly tomorrow.
Of course I'm using you for the wedding. Never saw her again. So I sang and then they dragged me in the office and they were like, right, Warner Brothers want to sign you. Do you want to be in a boy band? It's probably about 50 people on set. And she's like, here, have I got lipstick on my teeth? I said, yeah. So she looked at the teeth, she went, is it gone? I went, no. She went, get a fucking tissue and wipe my fucking teeth.
But the wedding day was chaotic, wasn't it?
It was chaotic, but you were very calm. You were like, it's just another red carpet.
Then we realised we've got the same name.
Well, no, wait, how long it took you, what, a year?
It's really confusing for invoicing purposes.
Oh, so,
he gets
don't
half
I know.
My money. It's been a love affair ever since.
Yeah.
This is a very special episode because I have two of my closest friends, confidants, and they head up the Attwood glam team, the Mikey and Mikey. On the other side of the camera, which I know is not an entirely comfortable thing for you, so I'm very grateful. You look more at ease, actually.
Just for you, darling.
Dash.
I think I've changed. I used to be at ease.
We'll get into Mikey's
I'm very
past.
Shy.
I feel like we'll warm you up. This is just basically us when we do our glam, but with loads of people and cameras and microphones.
Yeah, this is not quite
censoring what we actually say.
No censoring. We'll let the edit worry about that.
Okay.
I mean, it would be an understatement to say that you have both seen me at some of my lowest points.
I mean, dragging you around the floor of freedom is probably one of the lowest that I can remember.
I mean, I don't think for maybe the first 2 years of working together, you did a sober glam on me.
I mean, I really appreciate the time when I was basically blagging that I could do hair. And thanks to the Daily Mail, I saw that 5 days later, you were still wearing the off-centre pony that I'd managed to do on one of the nights.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's take it back to when we first met. Do you want to tell how you and I first met? Yeah, tell the truth.
So it was all the rage to be Love Island, and then you'd come out, you'd have a fashion collaboration.
You mean was all the rage?
Well, you know, we've moved on now. So it was in the Star, and it was such a big deal. And I think I was there working with, like, Billy Fairs. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then I hadn't watched your series, but I was excited to meet you because I'm always on the lookout for new meat.
Yeah.
And I do remember looking over and then I saw, you know, the amount of abuse that was actually going off in that corner.
In the corner of my eye, you're doing Billy. She literally looks like a work of art. Okay. And I was so jealous. I was like, that's a glam. That is. And then I got onto my agent, Chloe, and I was we need to get
it
Mikey.
It was the next day Miss Chloe got in touch.
Yeah.
I mean, very flattering for me, because obviously you'd seen the master at work. And yeah, literally the next day.
And then we worked together. I'd say, how long were you and I working together before Mikey Dash came into the picture? A good couple of years.
I feel like there were so many times, though, when we'd be in my car and you'd be like, you need to do Olivia, you need to do Olivia. And I'd be like, I just don't know.
What?
Yeah.
Wow.
I'd never watched the show. Like, and I just felt like, would we get on? And then the more I saw him do you and the more I saw of you, I was like, she's a bit of me.
Okay.
And then instantly, as soon as I met you, I was like, obsessed.
Because I feel like we've had at least 5 years, because I've seen off many a hairdresser.
Yeah.
There's been at least three.
So we've had different hairdressers, some good, some bad. And then you went for an era of like doing hair.
I was like, look, I can't watch these people cut your fringe with toenail scissors anymore. I'm going to have to bring out the wigs and see what I can do.
So, yeah. So that was, and then we basically, you introed us, we did a glam together. You came to my house, I believe, and you did a curly blow dry for me that lasted, no exaggeration, 8 working days. Yeah. I think I went on a bender, I had sex, I got caught in a storm, and not one hair moved from my fucking head. I was like,
that is a dash blow dry.
I was like, book him from now until eternity. He will do my wedding, he'll do my funeral, and everything in between.
You went, you're doing my wedding hair.
Yeah.
It's like, we'll see, sweetheart.
We'll see if someone wants to marry you first. Right, you both have had very, and are having very impressive careers. And I have lots of questions for you, and I know the viewers will be dying to know the history. So let's get into it. How did you two both meet?
Was it Tamara?
Well, I did meet you once at the This Morning Studios.
I don't think it was This Morning, was it? Was it not?
It was This Morning. I admired your shoes and practically ignored me.
Were they the crystal Louboutins?
They were.
The silver ones. I remember. Yeah, I ignored you. We did meet before that, though, back at the old ITV studios when you were doing Sam Bailey and I was doing The Pussy.
Shut up.
Yeah.
So you two met back then.
Who did we do together?
Tomorrow, I think. And then, yes. Was it when you were profusely sweating?
Yes.
Oh, my God, Mikey.
Oh, God, are we allowed?
Did you sign NDAs? I don't want to get in any legal trouble. I can't afford to help you.
Well, she did.
Yeah.
I've just bought a new Birkin, so you're literally on your own.
I mean, let's just say, she'll probably laugh at this.
Yeah.
It was my first time. So obviously...
Wait, doing makeup or doing her?
Doing her.
It was your first time doing a certain client?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I think I'd really wound myself up. So I remember running there, and then she lives down the longest street. So I was like, oh, it's not far. And then obviously
each
I was like...
house is quite a lot.
Yeah, it was like Linford Christie by the time I got there. And then you're met by security and then you're like, right, they're in the building, they're coming up the stairs. And before I know it, I mean, it was hotter than this room. It must have been 85 degrees Celsius.
It was very warm.
I had to set out all the kit on the floor and then I'm trying to pile the makeup on and then the sweat is literally...
But the way, I think you were like in... quite a difficult position and like leaning over.
Yeah, and I just thought she was looking into my eyes and thinking, who is this absolute cray?
Yeah.
So that was our first job together.
But that was the first day. And then the second time we did it together and I was like, just calm down. And I felt like you were calmer. And then she was like, oh, okay, he's not insane.
Yeah.
And how many years ago was that?
7 years.
Yeah.
It's been a love affair ever since.
Yeah. But literally from that first time, we just hit it off.
I know. Then we realised we've got the same name.
Then we realised.
Well, how long it took you, what, a year?
It's really confusing for invoicing purposes.
Oh, so
he gets half of my money.
It's confusing for many reasons because obviously I have the Mikeys on every job I do.
A retainer.
And then, you know, if one of the Mikeys is misbehaving, normally Phillips, then the other one might get in trouble. Like, people get them confused.
Right, I deny all rumours.
Okay. How did you get into makeup, both of you? How did you get your start and what did you do before?
Do you want first or me?
You go, hun.
You go, because yours...
You've had more of a, like, normal road, I feel.
Well, yeah, I feel like... But yours started way earlier than mine.
So in 1953... Right, I mean... First of all, I've had two careers.
First of all, tell us about the gold-selling album.
Right, so I've had two careers. So obviously, I'm obsessed with Kylie.
So as well as being a full-time celebrity makeup artist, Mikey is the like executive of the Kylie Minogue Stalker Association. Talk us through like the memorabilia, like or whatever. He's the number one fan.
Calendars.
He goes to every concert he can get his hands on.
I've seen her about 68 times.
68.
I've met her twice. I've been dragged away by security twice because they thought I was a stalker. I'm absolutely obsessed with her.
Okay.
So this was the plan. I lived in Wales growing up. You know, the only gay in the village, there's no one around. I hadn't even seen McDonald's. I was 18. So I was like, I need to get out of here. There must be more to life.
Yeah.
Go to drama school, get in. And then in the drama school, they had their own agency. So it'd only been there 3 months and they were like, right, we're doing a showcase.
Mm-hmm.
So I sang and then they dragged me in the office and they were like, right, Warner Brothers want to sign you. Do you want to be in a boy band? Well, obviously I thought I was going to be the next Kylie. I would settle for the Spice Girls. What they didn't tell me till the contracts were signed, it's really funny that I'm wearing this today, because this is a visual prop. When I landed in Germany, they were like, right, there's something we didn't tell you. This album is going to be produced by Enigma. So that's cool. It's like trancey, you know. What they didn't tell me is that we had to pretend to be monks. And also, I've got red hair, and they put me in a red robe. I mean, it's like a hate crime.
We need to get the footage.
Oh, there's a DVD, darling.
I know, because I've seen it.
There's music videos of me wandering around Santiago. And can I just tell you, underneath the robe, I was wearing buffaloes. Do you remember? Not dissimilar to these.
Stop, you were in buffaloes.
So I had buffaloes under this red robe. They're making me traipse around in the mountains.
In a Buffalo platform.
In 40 degree heat.
I remember
heat.
One point you were in a church or cathedral. And
I had my own shader because they said I had the face of an angel. They wanted me to maintain my pale skin. Yeah, and that went on for like a year and a half. And I was like, do you know what? The monk life is not for me. Yes, we had a duet with Sarah Brightman. Was it enough to keep me in the band? No.
So you're in the Tibetan mountains. You're singing. What
we
happens?
Were huge in South America.
You leave. You come back to the UK.
Then I was like, right, you know, what's next for me? Am I going to be in Mamma Mia? What's happening?
Yeah.
Ended up in a few episodes of like casualty, random Heartbeat. Stuff. Then I was like, I thought this world was about talent and it's not, it's about who you know and luck. I was like, I've got a great voice, I'm going to be famous.
But it's more than that.
And I needed someone on the inside.
You need like a bit of nepotism sprinkled.
Yeah.
Okay, so you come back, you realise you're not going to be Kylie.
So then there I am, unemployed in a department store in Croydon, spraying fragrance, Angel, I remember it because I can still smell it. And then there was a Bobby Brown counter and they were like, do you do makeup? And I was like, yeah.
So you had no like official training?
No training.
Brand. You self-taught?
Self-taught, YouTube. And then obviously when you work for a brand, they go, this is what Bobby says.
This is their way of doing it.
But this would go as far as Bobby says to use an eyeshadow base, one colour over the lid and an eyeliner.
Yeah.
And that's where we used to get into trouble because they'd be like, ooh, Mikey, what have you done?
Because do you remember the Bobby Brown Beauty Bible, yeah. The book? Because I think I received that. Isn't this such a full circle moment? I received that. I think I was like literally about 13.
You tried to age me.
No, but isn't it weird that like at that time you were working for Bobby and it was Jen, my mum, that gave it to me. I think it was when I first like found a black eyeliner and then she was like, oh my fucking God. She was like, read this. Like threw it at me. Yeah. But it was a great book.
Well, I think I was lucky because it's an amazing brand.
It's insane.
And then I was like, I think I want celebrities. And the first person who changed the game for me through that brand, because they sold in salons, I met Amy Childs.
Oh, wow.
So then I ended up doing Amy's makeup for a demo and then I started working with Amy. And that then led to the Essex Massive and Towie was huge at that point.
Yeah.
So then it was all the Essex girls. And then I had another phase of I was the Love Island go-to. Mm-hmm. So it was just after you. I'd never watched your series. But then I would have the like Ambers, the Molly Mays. Always had to be the winner or the top three.
Yeah.
Anyone below? No.
No.
And then now, I mean, 2 weeks ago, I was working with Niecy Nash, who had literally just won the Emmy for Best Supporting Actress in Dharma and that had flown in to work with me. It's
what
like crazy.
A fucking journey.
Mel B.
Mel B. Wait, I want to get on to Claire's. Hold on.
Too much.
Hold on. I want to go. Your road to glam was a little bit more organic and
He actually, did you train?
Yeah, I trained as a soon and then obviously.
So wait, out of school, did you know you wanted to do hair?
No, I thought I wanted to do fashion and then basically I remember going into my hair salon asking for a very elaborate haircut. I can't remember what it was at the time, but she was like, you're very finicky about what you want. Have you ever considered doing hair? And I was like, that's ridiculous. And then I remember being like, oh, maybe. I remember going home and like talking to my mom and being like, I think I'm going to be a hairdresser. And then, yeah, it kind of happened like that. But I remember like the first time I started doing hair, it just clicked and I was like, I feel like this is for me.
Yeah.
Very strange. But my kind of first, like into this, the world I'm in now, I feel like my first kind of client that brought me into that was Katie Price. Obviously I worked with her for like 6 years and I was with her pretty much every day.
Because you did salons first, didn't you?
Yeah.
And then Kate was your first...
like freelance celebrity who I...
And how did you get booked with Katie the first time? Do you remember?
Yeah, a friend of mine, Lauren Pope from Towie, she was a really good friend of mine and Kate signed her with her agency. And then I remember doing a shoot and Kate turned up one day. And it's really weird because like, obviously back then I specialised in hair extensions. And I was all about, like, that hair, that life. I remember everyone used to say to me back then, like, who's, your dream client? And I used to be like, oh, like, I feel like Katie Price is the epitome of, like, hair extensions and, like, big fake hair. I feel like one day, like, I'll do her hair. And always knew that she would find me. Yeah, one day she walked into this shoot with Lauren and she was like, I love her hair. And I was like, thanks. And then she was gone. And I was like, that was weird. like, I felt like it was going to happen very differently. I felt like she was going to be like, I'm obsessed with you. I want you to do my hair.
Yeah.
It just didn't happen like that. And then about, I think it was about a month later, I was having a birthday party. And literally 2 days before the birthday party, I had a call. And it was some guy from OK Magazine. It was like, hi, Mikey. It's Tarkan from OK Mag. Katie Price wants you on a shoot in Marbella. You got to fly tomorrow. Do you want to do it? And I was like, I have to cancel my birthday party. And I cancelled it and flew to Marbella.
Did you actually?
Did the shoot with her. And then she used me continuously after that. So like for 6 years, I was with her like pretty much every day.
And I feel like the look that she had that time was so iconic.
Oh, it was iconic.
And yeah. I feel like, again, another weird feels like moment is that I was probably at home trying to recreate the looks that you were doing on her, because she was like my glam icon.
Emmy, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I said to you earlier, like, is that Kate was probably the first person in the UK to really celebrate having a glam squad.
Mm.
And that really celebrate kind of like kind of really talking about the fact that she doesn't do it herself. It's very much her makeup artist, her hairdresser. And I feel like in the US, Kim started doing that as well. But
yeah,
obviously back then, like, do you remember when Kim tweeted about seeing Kate on a flight?
Mm.
And obviously, like, she was a fan of Katie Price, because Katie Price at that point was massive. But I feel like, till this day, I feel like we still kind of owe her so much for kind of making our industry very celebrated. That whole time, it was absolute chaos, but I loved it.
What's something with people who are listening to this and want to get into this industry, what's something that you've learned on the job that can't be taught in makeup school?
I think you have to have passion for it and you have to love what you do.
I mean, we're always exhausted, aren't we? I think the three of us all work extremely hard, but I think we almost feel like we don't work because we're so obsessed with what we do. We love it so much.
But also, I feel like for us, we're so lucky because where we're kind of busy enough to be able to choose who we work with, I always say, like, we spend too much time with our clients to not enjoy what we do. So we get to work with some of our best friends. Like, it's really lovely to really enjoy what you do and to go to work and really, like, feel like, I can't believe I'm getting paid for this.
Someone trying to break into celebrity hair and makeup.
Don't do it.
What would you say about freebies? Because I know it's a very controversial issue in the glam world.
No, honestly, I feel like that is the demise of our industry. I've always said my entire career, if you're good at something, charge for it. Because I've never, ever, ever done freebies.
Something actually that I think shocks people on Instagram, people assume, I don't know why, that, like, I don't pay you guys. Like,
oh, no,
which blows my fucking
mind.
You
do, and you never argue with
I've never
rate.
Had a free glam.
She does moan about when the invoice goes in.
No, I don't.
Your invoice, maybe.
I don't moan. My agents might moan when you've added a zero.
I think what I would say in 2024 is maybe if there's someone you really wanted to work with, you would maybe go, okay, I'll give you a trial.
Right.
One session, maybe.
But not on a, obviously.
Absolutely not. And none of this, like, oh, I'd tag you on Instagram
with
your shadow. Because at the end of the day, it doesn't benefit you. That doesn't pay your bills.
I just think if you're good at something, charge for it. But also, even assistants that I've used in the past, I'll always make sure they get paid very fairly. Mm. I just think, like, these days, like, you've got to hustle, you've got to do it. I don't think offering yourself for free will work. The only time I've ever done you for free was your wedding. When I didn't know what to get you as a wedding gift. And yeah. I was like, I'll just give you my time.
No, Mike did it. And he threw that invoice in hard.
Darling, but I did your entire family.
Well, I know. My mum,
including your father.
My mum misbehaved, so that's why I couldn't have expected.
I just had a really good point then as well. Oh, here we go, because we're going deep now.
Mm.
The other thing with not charging, it actually screws us as professionals.
Yeah.
So the problem is, you know, we're very lucky and we're in a position where you can choose and you can go, oh, that fee's not for me. Or we're very good at haggling now and negotiating for ourselves.
Mm.
But the other problem of that is there are people who will do it for free. So someone will go, well, I want to pay you X amount for this job. And if you don't do it, I can get someone who's going to do it for free.
Mm-hmm. You don't get the respect.
You don't get the respect. Because like you said, if you're free or cheap, that's how you're known. I want to be known as I'm expensive.
Yeah.
And I'm worth it.
Hey guys, welcome to this week's What the Foxy Moments, sponsored by Foxy Bingo. I've got your questions. Let's do it. Dear Olivia, I think I speak for all the women who have watched your podcast, but please tell us, does Pete Wicks smell as good as he looks? Georgia in Nottingham.
Well, the power I hold in this situation. There is sometimes a faint cigarette smell, which I'm sure he would be fine with me telling you. But then normally it's covered by a very nice deodorant. I mean, to be honest, I try not to get super close to him if I can avoid it. But that is what I can tell you. Hi, Olivia. This Mother's Day, I did myself proud for my mum. Flowers, afternoon tea, gifts galore, personal note, an awesome card. I was on fire. My brother, on the other hand, bought a bunch of dead-looking daffodils, a classic own-brand chocolate box, and a god-awful card. It felt 100% like last-minute purchase from the local garage. But guess who gets all the love, thanks, and full-on emotional tears? Him. Seriously, what is it with mums and boys? Claire in Swansea. By the way, loving the podcast. Please, please, please do not stop. Oh my God, thanks, Claire. I have no intention of stopping anytime soon till someone takes this mic from my deathly grip. However, going back to your issue, like, we don't need to go into a whole emotional incest thing, but there's definitely something there with mums and sons. In some cases, it is a bit of a Freudian nightmare. And they just seem to get away with more. Mums are just tougher on girls, like, period. Like, me and my sister, I feel, had a completely different upbringing to my brother. I don't know. I can't explain it. I'm not a psychologist, but there is something there, and it's nothing to do with you. I would just do the dead daffodils next year and see how she likes it. Hello, Liv. Listened to the Georgia Harrison episode and heard you two talking about Love Island waxing, and it got me thinking. Is it appropriate to ask your partner to get waxed if they're really hairy? My partner's back is like a matted carpet, and I'd really like for him to be a bit smoother. Nina from Bolton. Nina, hi. From the lovely Bolton. You're not far from me, actually. I don't think it's bad at all, especially if you're in a long-term relationship. I'm guessing that you take care of business in terms of hair. So I feel like you're within your rights to ask your partner to kind of meet you halfway on that. I feel like waxing is quite intense, and men, I think, have a low pain threshold. So maybe you could ease him in with like a Veet situation or a razor situation, and then work your way up to waxing. But I definitely don't think you should be putting up with what you've quoted as a matted carpet, because that sounds foul. Thank you for listening to this week's What the Foxy Moments. I will see you next time. What makes a dream client?
Someone who's loyal and respectful of what you do.
That's very hard to find.
Yeah. Like, we always say we really honour loyalty, and if someone makes sure that they fight for their team, if they fight for our fees, if they make sure that we're treated well, I think that goes such a long way.
Yeah.
But I think also a dream client isn't just, I'm going to work with that person and just work with that person. There's a synergy that happens, and it's like, I could work with you, but you might not be right for me. So then you kind of fall by the wayside. So it's about finding those people who live for how you make them look.
But also, I feel like who let us as well shine and let us kind of try things and push their own
boundaries. Well, yeah, they trust you as well.
How do you manage a difficult client?
Get rid of them.
Yeah. Snip, snip.
That's not who, if you're in your chair and you're already in and they're being difficult, you have had difficulties, you've had to see it through.
I had the worst person I've ever had, and I said, darling, just do yourself.
What, halfway through?
Yeah, because I said, you're never going to be happy. I went, so there you go, you do yourself. Never saw her again.
I've had clients as well that I'm just like, this just didn't click. Like, I'm not obsessed with you, and I just won't book them in again.
And also, I'm used to when they look in the mirror going, oh my God, I'm obsessed. And this one, I spun round into the mirror, and she was like,
I remember who this was as well. I remember who this was. Hilarious.
She's the person who, this is another thing, I did the job for the money.
Right.
My head got turned. I knew it was in the wrong, it was in the right fit for me.
Okay.
And it's the least person you would put with me.
Yeah.
And you also wouldn't expect that behaviour.
You're not going to say, are you?
Associated with the royals, that's all I'll say. But wrong for me. Apparently her eyebrows were too modern.
Too modern?
I said, welcome to the 20th century.
That's a niche.
I know.
Complaint.
I know.
Nightmare client story.
I've told this story many times.
Do I know it?
Behind the scenes. You know the person, and we have blanked them together once. It was a very weird day. Started doing the glam. She was like, I can't even do the impression because it's going to give it away.
Right.
Loving the makeup. Next thing, disappears for about an hour and a half. I'd only got to the like baking stage of the makeup.
Right.
So then an hour and a half later, she comes back. She went, what's going on with my makeup? Get it off, start again. I was like, okay, weird. Then telling me what to use. So I felt like I was in like the sea with like a great white shark. It was like, it was relentless.
But you're just trying to avoid getting bit.
Yeah, and she was like slagging off all my clients. I was going to say customers. Slagging off all my other clients and said, I don't want to look like them. You need to up your game.
You wish.
You need to up your game if you're going to work with me. And then we got to the end look and she was like, why can you do that in the beginning? And like off to set goes. Anyway, fast forward, there's one bit where I had to change to a red lip. And then there's the clicking of the fingers. It's probably about 50 people on set. And she's like, here, have I got lipstick on my teeth? Can you tell I'm trying not to give away?
Yeah.
I mean, someone's going to get a prize if they guess who it is. Have I got lipstick on my teeth? I said, yeah. So she looked at the tissue and is it gone? I went, no. She went, get a fucking tissue and wipe my fucking teeth. So I go over there with a baby wipe and I'm questioning my entire career while I'm wiping this bitch's teeth.
Oh my, as you spoke to that in front of everyone.
Spoken over that. And you're going to be shocked at this.
Yeah.
She actually made me cry.
But that wasn't the last time you did her, was it?
Oh no, we'll come to that. But I didn't cry in front of her.
Oh, Mikey, that makes me really angry.
So then I quit, reported her to the agent, and then I think maybe it was a year later.
But he's probably a victim too of the abuse.
He looked absolutely terrified. He was in the corner. You're right, dropped her. I said, I'll never work with her again.
Yeah.
I tripled my fee and then started again.
And then what was the final straw the second time?
I could see the signs. So she was very repentful and, you know, oh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
But then I saw the flags appearing. The final performance saying that I'd made her look like a pig. I was like,
to be fair,
we're done.
To be fair, she looked great, I think, in that look.
She did. And even dinner at the Corinthia wouldn't cut it.
No.
Because sometimes, kids, the money's not enough.
But be fucking nice to people. Be gracious. Be humble.
Well, where is she now?
Where is she now?
Exactly. I don't know.
That was the most Welsh she's ever sounded.
I don't know.
I thought it was American.
Who's the most famous person you've glammed?
I feel like I'd have to say Adele.
Well, that's just a fucking mic drop right there.
Or Rebel. I feel like
Rebel,
both of them are.
Yeah,
both
they're great. But Adele's Adele. But
Adele's
you,
Adele.
Mel B. Spice. You can't get bigger than a Spice Girl.
I can't be a Spice Girl.
I just did.
No, we'll see in 20 years.
Who is on, I already know your answer to this, who would be the dream person to get your hands on?
It is the Minogue, isn't it?
Yeah. But would you be too fucking nervous?
I feel like you'd be too nervous.
I mean, again.
Would you be crying and sweating while trying to do...
Sweating like an old fridge in the corner. Who else I'd like to... I'd love to do Pammy.
Oh, yeah. Pammy, she's got no makeup now.
I know. I mean, Pammy, I was here for a one-off, but no.
We need some
concealer on.
Yeah. What about you, Dash?
I feel like Pammy would be a good one, or like Rosie Huntington-Whiteley. I feel like it would be good. I'm a little bit obsessed with Claudia Winkleman. I just feel like that could just be a vibe.
I'd love to see you get their hands on that fringe. Mm. Product you can't live without.
Is it only one?
I'll give you two.
All right, then.
I'm being nice, though.
Has to be the holy grail for makeup artists. Laura Mercier translucent powder.
Yeah.
I'd like it in translucent and translucent honey.
Yeah.
So two shades we mix together. And then what is another insane product? Do you know what? I'm going to go with a new product.
Go on.
Our favourite Kryolin setting spray, which basically the Liverpool girls will know.
Also, I love that you're like, close your eyes and don't breathe in.
Yeah,
spray
don't
it
breathe
and
in.
And I'm stood behind her.
It's like that, it's like that glue hairspray for your face.
Because I used to, back in the day, hairspray my makeup on for pageants and stuff.
And you've had a few recent glams where you said, we've done you in the morning.
That's
you're in another city in the night. Hasn't moved.
That's all day.
Karen Brady on the phone the other day.
Yeah.
We'd done her in the morning.
Move.
At night, she's at the match. No, she said even the lip gloss.
Gorgeous.
I know.
Favourite glam we've ever done, three of us.
God.
The wedding was a great glam. I think it's one of the best makeups we've ever done, which is just like...
Your makeup was sensitive.
And the hair was like, I loved the hair. But the wedding day was chaotic, wasn't it? I mean, holy fucking
did
shit.
Did your entire family?
Well, this is the thing. It was chaotic, but you were very calm. And like, when I said to you, like,
yeah, I was
you're
like,
very calm, you were like, it's just another red carpet.
And I was having a very good day. I was like, everything's going right.
Yeah.
More than right. I was literally like, it was like magical. And then your dad's in the chair. Max is in the chair.
Yeah, they started appearing for glam. Not, by the way, let's just like, I didn't want glam. My mum started telling everyone they needed glam.
Yeah.
I think my mum thought you were just there to just continuously glam. And I was like, no, he's only booking but to do like your glam, my sister's glam, me.
Were you thinking of the invoice?
I mean, I knew you were going to fucking arse fuck me with the invoice. The more people I saw in that chair,
I actually gave you I gave you mates rates.
Yeah, and it was eye-watering at that. So I'm looking at my mum. My mum's like this. Mikey, yeah, my mother, she's got some shine here. My grandmother, by the way, is 91. And she's like, she looks like crap. I'm like, she's 91, mum. Like, please, just go easy. I'm like, you're there, like, you know, trying to dust the thing. And my nan's like, leave me alone. But yeah, what a woman. You have this like bad history of weddings where like loyal clients of his who use him for everything have then gone and like booked someone else for the wedding and then hated it anyway. So he had this weird like paranoia that I wasn't going to book him for the wedding.
And they all say the same things to me. They always go, of course I'm using you for the wedding.
Even gaslighting.
There was even one that I'd worked with for 6 years and then she was like, see you in January. Never saw her again. So I do have this like PTSD of like, okay, I've been here. I've even been told I'm doing the wedding, then had it taken back.
Oh, fucking hell.
I do like to do the most.
Yeah.
I like to do multiple. I do multiple clients.
Yeah, but not so bad anymore.
Do you think?
Are you joking?
No, because there used to be a time, right, when Mikey would do, I'm not joking, like 15 bodies for the NTAs.
God, that was terrible.
And he would run in the Intercontinental the O2 from room to room, having heart palpitations.
I remember doing one of them in the lift once. I was like...
Because he didn't want it, but now you don't.
No.
It's like three of us, and I way prefer it.
And like Mikey said, we've got to this phase of we're selective now. Whereas I think... I don't know, maybe the NTAs, I'd go, I'll do.
And I'm quite possessive over my look, right? My look has been on a fucking journey. We don't, you know, the photos are there to thing. But being in this industry and doing this thing, it's like, I'm inspired by people. I copy, if Kim K does sick hair, I copy it, whatever. Like, you always take inspiration from other people's looks. But there was this time, and we're not going to name check, so just think, but there was a time there was this particular person, and I felt like they were doing everything but skinning me and wearing me as a coat. So I put it to my attention. I was like, you're doing, like, copycat glams of me. Like, to the point of the hair, the makeup, like, a few days later. And I was like, it's starting to fucking freak me out, and it's starting to piss me off. So I was like, no, don't say the name.
Go on.
No, because
I'm convinced she's wearing your old eyelid.
No,
what she's about to say, she made me choose.
I said, you're not doing us both the NTAs because it's getting fucking stupid now.
But obviously being an Aquarius, I was like, you do you, darling.
He was like, I'm not being bullied.
I said, I won't be told who to do.
I mean, good for you.
That worked
out.
Then
I cried myself to sleep. Because she unbooked me and booked someone else.
But she regretted that, though.
She did regret that when she saw the pics.
You fucking bitch. We're nearly done. Mikey does this thing to me. And sometimes it's like he can't do my glam because his schedule. And he'll send me the picture that I've been out in public on a red carpet on a TV show. I mean, you're beautiful, but you've looked better.
No, isn't my favourite when you go, oh, Mikey, there's a shoot on blah, blah, and I go, yeah, can you move it to the next week?
Yeah, he's like, can you move the 25 people that are going to be on that shoot because I can't do it? I'm like...
Can you move it to like that night?
It kills me that you try and fit everything in around your schedule and he'll be like, do you know what would be great if you did, instead of Monday morning, if you did Tuesday afternoon because I've got this morning?
Yeah. Just love to try and make it work, you know?
I know.
For you.
For all of us.
Such a big part of the glam team is actually away from the hair and makeup as well. Like, it's the fact that, like, I can talk to you, I trust you, like, you're my friends. Like, those days I've got low energy, you hype me up. Like, and I wouldn't sacrifice having, you know, subpar glam for that. But it's really important to have both. Like, and I just think you can have the best makeup in the world, but if that person doing you has got the personality of a wet rag, like, it just actually just bums you out. Like, so the personality being a match, and you just know me so well. So it's like, you know when I'm a bit erratic, when you can't keep me in the chair, you know when I'm stressed.
You, Mikey, erratic?
Also, Mikey Phillips doesn't drink. Dash drink. So that
now and again.
We do party together.
I like a Prosecco.
You like a Prosecco and you like to go to the theatre, which but I also, can't.
But you'll take yourself home at a sensible hour. Me and Liv would be the last one standing, dragging each other around a floor in some nightclub in Soho. Yeah. probably ending up back, let's have one quick drink for the road back at your hotel, and then you'll be up in 2 hours for filming.
So
it's very age.
I do still throw it down, but just far less regularly.
Yeah.
For me, that is the number one. I describe you as a good girl.
Per the sign, I'm going to read to you an activity or a thing, and then you tell me whether it's wrong or right. Because obviously, it can be so wrong, it's right. So he's right on the nose there. Restaurant kleptomania.
Is that me?
It's stealing things from restaurants.
Oh, no, that's not me.
I mean, I feel like there's a time and a place. Like, yeah. They expect you to steal certain things. Like, those little fishes from Sexy Fish.
Yeah, and the Harry's teaspoons. They're like, steal me.
Right? So, I mean, anything silver.
Yeah.
My mother did steal the chopsticks from Wagamama. Does that count?
At least,
she didn't even break them apart.
Oh.
What?
Do you ever steal anything from restaurants?
No.
You're very well behaved, Mikey.
Not the food.
Yeah. Would you ever take a nice salt shaker from the table?
No.
Oh, you're far too
sweet. I'm sure I've got some of the Soho House silver ones at home.
Oh, God.
However, we
hope you enjoyed your membership because you've just lost it.
What?
We have stolen for someone else.
For someone else?
What?
Oh, my God, we did.
Yeah.
That is a story that can't go on camera.
No, we've signed an NDA.
Are you actually serious? No,
we took a whole dinner service. Yeah.
Mikey basically took a tea set for one of our clients from a hotel.
She had some bits missing and needed to replace.
Yeah, so literally as he walked out, his set bag was like clinking. I was like, what's going on?
That's even better than restaurant. Yeah. That's hotel robbery. That's a heist.
The Charlotte Street Hotel.
If you're missing
a whole dinner service.
Oh, wow.
Pretending you didn't see someone you know on the street.
Oh, God, always.
Oh, I do that all the time.
Always.
I actually, to be fair, my long-distance vision is
same.
Crap. So sometimes not even my fault, but then if I do see them...
And I've got a worse version of that. I actually don't remember. I don't remember them.
No.
And they all know me. I don't know who they are.
Mikey Phillips. Everyone
knows. I just always feel like if they're far away or if it's like low light... Like,
no, like,
your guess is good
in
as
the hours
I'm
dust.
Blind. Yeah, exactly. I'm basically blind.
I also was mugged 3 times, so I do cross the road.
Oh, Jesus, Mike.
I know.
What, you got, like, attack me written on your fucking forehead?
Apparently, I just look wealthy. That's what the police told me. They did.
You need to pour it up a little bit.
I had to move.
Oh, God. He doesn't ever, he's never on the street.
No.
Yeah. Straight from his car to the door.
Exactly.
Pretending to understand something when you don't.
Yeah.
Like with these questions.
Yeah. I mean, I asked Mikey for some pictures for the gram for yesterday for a show that hasn't even happened. Because I thought it was a different day.
Oh.
Does that count?
Kind of. I think it's more if someone tells you a story and they're going...
I often nod long. I'm always like,
You said it to me earlier. You went, blah, blah, you referenced someone. And I went, yeah. I went, wait, who?
There we go.
I think it depends. It's a dangerous one to... Pretend you understand something, but then, because if there's follow-up questions, you're screwed.
Yeah, I also mean that, again, there's a time and a place. Like, you couldn't do it in a work situation.
But someone you know well, I think you can just be like, oh, what the fuck?
Yeah.
This question's quite different.
I feel like it's wrong.
So it's all right. We're getting through. Ignoring a phone call from a number you don't know.
Absolutely.
Constantly.
Yeah.
If your name isn't there, it's not being answered.
You see...
I just don't like answering the phone.
You probably know this from doing my being with me so much, but I always answer because the curiosity eats me alive. I've never not answered a phone call.
If it's that important, they'll leave a voicemail.
I don't know. Especially, like, even if it's 0800, I'm like, straight away, hello? Like, I don't know what I think I've done wrong, but I'm always, like, very... I don't know, I'm always on high alert, so I have to answer everything. Having imaginary arguments in the mirror... with people you want to have an argument with?
Never in the mirror, but in my own head. And then I'm fuming.
Or in the shower.
Definitely reenacted something. Nothing's coming to me at this point.
You definitely have.
Yeah, 100%.
When you go home stewing on the often...
I just pretend people are dead quite often.
Yeah, you're quite good at that.
I feel like the amount of times you've had imaginary arguments with different makeup artists...
Okay, they're my nemesis. People are like, they're my nemesis. And we're like, from what? And you're like, I just hate
them. Yeah.
Yeah.
I just attract drama. I don't know what it is. Follows me.
We'll unpack this in a minute because you're actually way less drama now. You've mellowed. Oh, I don't know how to say that. He literally tried to get someone fired the other day.
Exactly.
Stories. stalking, hardcore stalking people you work with on social media?
I mean, you, to be fair, I mean, I'm grassing you up, but like, if we've done like a glam, you will literally be stalking to see when the pictures are out.
Oh no, I feel I know you so well. I can even tell from the way you post.
In what sense?
So it could be like, there was a, I could be outing myself as an absolute cray right here. So there was one day you had to do your own makeup. He did your hair.
No, we were in the lift.
Is this
and he
a
was
different
like,
conversation?
Yeah, and we were
no,
in the lift.
No, but tell the story because I know this story, but I disagree, but go on.
So I feel I know you this well that he, I always go, oh, how was today? Because obviously I wasn't there. He'd be like, oh, it's amazing. She looked amazing. And I go, she hasn't posted though.
No, but we had a separate conversation. Do you remember we got into the lift and you went, I'm obsessed with myself today.
Yeah.
And then we did the picture outside and we were like, smashed it.
I know what you mean. Sometimes you're on the money with that, but I think that day, the outfit was like, was giving.
You did have glasses on as well.
But I can't see. This is the other thing. When I'm doing live telly and sometimes there's teleprompter or like whatever, I do need my glasses. Like, I have a massive issue with contact lenses. I can't put my finger in my eye.
Not with those nails.
But then if Mikey doesn't let, if he doesn't my glam, he tries to not let me wear my glasses because he says it ruins.
I mean, the viewers going to understand this because obviously.
But then I'm like, but I can't see.
I can't see either. I nearly took the loose women Christmas tree with me.
Well, we know about you.
I know.
When you
one swoop move, I nearly took Linda Robson and the tree. I thought it was the end for me.
He's leaving the stage on the ad break of Loose Women, and we just heard this like, dah, 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 and like a bauble just like bounced across the stage. Fancying your mate's dad.
Absolutely not.
No.
Wrong. Wrong.
Oh. Yeah, I feel like anyone fancying anyone's like your friend said, you can't do that.
If it's your real friend, I think it's weird to fancy any of their blood relatives.
Yeah.
I have to say, that's probably like a boring thing to say.
Let's face it, whose dad is actually hot?
No one I know.
Exactly, neither do I.
I think that, isn't it? I think the dads are only hot in like porn and TV shows. Like really,
I think
the
if your
real
like
dad.
Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah.
Tom Cruise.
Yeah, but then like also, like, their kids wouldn't be your mate.
How do you know?
Well, because, like, you're of a certain age. You wouldn't be hanging around with those children.
How dare you? Are you trying to out me on here as vintage?
I can tell them your age.
Don't.
I'll tell them that me a surgeon.
Thank you for playing my box of wrong. Well, I have loved this. It's been really fun.
It's has
weird
been.
Not working, doesn't it?
This feels really weird to be chatting and not doing makeup. I said, like, do you feel like you should be doing something with your hands?
Yeah. I don't think we're never off duty.
Yeah.
Well, I'm currently looking at your hair going, why didn't I bring a brush?
Do I look a hot mess?
No.
No.
Gorgeous. Cute.
Thanks for coming the other side of the camera for the day.
We didn't really have a choice, did we?
No.
We entered our careers.
Well...
You've nearly been cancelled.
Let's see what the edit says.
Takes a lot to shake you down.
I'll be back on QVC.
Boys, thank you so much for coming on.
It's been such a pleasure.
I'll send you the invoice.
Oh, fuck. I thought that was coming. This week's episode of So Wrong It's Right was brought to you by Foxy Bingo. Put some Fox in your day with new, quick and interactive bingo experiences all at the tip of your finger. They have a huge range of free, classic and exclusive games you can play with your mates to keep the party going. Want to connect with other players? Foxy Bingo has a community chat so you can always feel part of the Foxy pack. So get your Fox on by heading to Foxy Bingo today. 18+, begambleaware.org, T's and C's apply.